for being here. I'm Janet Schaeffler. I'm an Adrian Dominican sister. I live in the Detroit vicinity, a suburb of Detroit. So I'm excited and glad to be here. And I think this is phenomenal for the number of people that gather for a whole day Saturday to keep on growing in your own faith so that you can continue to share it. So this topic, this session, is on the creed. And as a lot of things that we do in sessions like this, it's a gigantic topic to do in a very short time. So just keep that in mind. We're really only scratching the surface of things that we could look at about the creed. And some of you might be aware that I have a book on the creed, which was built by, or entitled by 23 Publications as the Creed, a Catechist's Guide to Understanding What We Believe and What We Teach. A lot of people have told me, too, that they're using it with RCIA people, with a lot of adult faith formation groups, people who are gathered, and like use it as a book site so that they go through it to keep understanding and grow more deeply, too, in what the Creed is all about. So we're just going to, as I say, touch on a few things, a few general things, about helping ourselves to look more closely at the creed. So first of all, creeds begin with, I believe, or we believe. So if you were, right now, to summarize what you believe about your faith in one sentence, what would you say? Can you jot that down? Or if you want to just think about it in your mind, that's okay. How would you finish the sentence, I believe in, to express what you believe about your faith? Anybody want to share with us what your sentence is? Okay, right back there.
The creed I can sum into, I believe in one God, His holy Catholic Church, and His apostolic church.
Okay.
And that's what I believe.
Great, thank you. Thank you. Anybody else?
I would say that I believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God who brought us eternal life, or earned for us eternal life through death on the cross, and His church continues its work today.
Good. Okay, thanks. Okay, right there.
I just wrote, I believe in all the Catholic Church teaches and believes.
That takes care of everything, doesn't it? Okay.
I believe in the plan of God that He wishes all His people to be united with Him in heaven.
Thanks. It might be hard to put it into one sentence, but sometimes when we do that too, it gives us a sense of where we are and what we're thinking and what's important to us. So, we all know that, of course, there's two major creeds. The Nicene Creed, which we recite often at liturgy, especially on Sundays, and also the Apostles' Creed, which we also can use on Sundays. We have the option of using either one. The Apostles' Creed also is the prayer that we use at the beginning of praying the Rosary. So perhaps maybe our first question is, where did these creeds come from? And in reality, if you want to study the history, there's lots and lots and lots written about where they came from. But everyone would agree that the creeds we have today originate in the baptismal ceremony. A creed was the part of the baptismal rite in which people were introduced into the Christian community. And as the people were introduced through baptism in the community, they usually responded to questions. Sometimes it was three questions, sometimes it was more. And those questions centered on the Trinity. As some of you already said, when you wrote your one sentence, you started mentioning the persons of the Trinity. And so in these early baptismal rites, these questions and answers, whether or not they were very elaborate, or they were very short, or whether they had lots of phrases and clauses that went along with them, or maybe just two or three clauses. Whatever it is, no matter how elaborate or short it was, these questions and answers were the origin of what we have today as the creed. So the history of our creeds, our creed arises today, the ones we use today, arise from the baptismal ceremony, and especially the baptismal ceremonies in the early church. So think about that for a moment, the idea that the creeds originate in baptism. One of my favorite questions for trying to invite people to think about baptism is, remember what St. Paul said in the letter to the Romans about baptism. And Paul says that it's something that everybody, that all the early Christians in Rome already knew, that he wasn't telling them something different. Because he says, don't you know? And of course the implication of that is, well, yes, of course we do. So Paul says in the letter to the Romans, don't you know that when you were baptized, you died with Christ, you were buried with Christ, and have been risen again from the dead with Christ? So if you have died to your old sinful life, you are now raised as a whole new creature, and you must live accordingly. Now, we've heard that passage frequently throughout our journey in our faith. And so it might not strike us, because it's become so common to us, it might not strike us how strange that really is. I mean, would you usually talk, think about yourself, would you usually talk about joining a group, joining an organization, joining a community in terms of dying and then rising to new life? Would you think of joining the Republican or the Democratic Party and think of it as, yes, I used to be a Republican, but I died to the Republican Party, and I'm now raised to a new life as a Democrat, or vice versa? I think we would say that's a bit much about how I feel. But would you join the Knights of Columbus, or would you join a women's spirituality group and describe it to a friend of yours as, I died and I rose again? It's not the usual language that we use today. So why does Paul use it? And why does he use it as though it's something that everybody knows? He doesn't write as though he's making this up, that it's something new he just thought of, that it's original with him, that he's the first one to use it. Paul says, don't you know this? And he presumes the answer is yes, we've all heard that before. Because for the early Christian community to enter into baptism was putting your life on the line. For the early Christians, they viewed baptism as they were changing everything about their life. They were changing their relationship to their family, to to their friends, certainly to the empire of which they were members. And the early Christians, many of them, when they were baptized, also had to change their occupation or their profession. Because in the early church, there was a long list of occupations that baptized Christians couldn't be a part of, because it was contradictory to what their beliefs were. So anything that they saw that was connected to pagan worship, they couldn't be a part of. So it wasn't only that they couldn't work in temples anymore, but they couldn't be painters or sculptors, because to them that was false worship. It was creating idols. The early Christians saw statues, sculptures, paintings as an idol that was being created. They couldn't be producers of plays. They couldn't be gladiators or charioteers. There was a whole long list of things that they couldn't do. So if they were any of those professions, when they were baptized, they had to give them up and start over anew with a new occupation. So when they accepted baptism, quite literally, their old self, everything who they had been to that point in their life, was over. It was as if they had died. And now we're starting a new life. Had come back as a new person. Had been raised as a new creature. And Paul meant that very seriously. But not just Paul, so did the early Christian community. They saw baptism as totally starting over, as dying and beginning a whole new life. And so it's in this context that people first started reciting creeds. So creeds are enormously crucial statements in which we glorify God and state our commitment. And that's important because, I don't know if you read the description of this session, but one of the things I tried to say was, it's not just about saying the creed. It's not just about reciting the creed when we pray or when we're at liturgy. It's also about living it. The reality that because of these realities, that are the foundation of who I am, of who we are as a community, what happens now? Who am I now? How do I live now? Does what I am saying have an impact upon how I'm living? So another question we might ask is, how would we describe or define what a creed is? How would we answer the question, what is a creed? Let's look at a couple things about that. One important thing to notice about the creed is that it isn't just a list of things we believe. It would be a mistake for us to think of the creed, either one of them, as a kind of handy little summary statement of the principal headings of Catholic doctrine, of Christian doctrine. It's not, as it were, the table of contents to the catechism. That's not what the creed is. So if that's what it's not, what is it? Before we get to what is it, let's look at, for a moment again about what it's not. If we began by thinking that the creed was a listing of the topics, the themes of the main beliefs of our Christian faith, we'd expect the two creeds that we have to have exactly the same list. But in reality, they don't. And so if you want to just look at one of your handouts, the handout that has both the Nicene Creed and the Apostles' Creed on it,
Yes.
So for example, the Nicene Creed tells us very explicitly about the Holy Spirit. That creed says, the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. And then it goes on to tell us that the Spirit spoke through the prophets. And that probably means they're talking both about the inspired teachers of the first generation of Christians, the first generation of people after Jesus, but also the prophets of the Old Testament, that it was the Spirit that inspired Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Isaiah and the other prophets of the scriptures. That's an interesting thing to look at, because if you look at the Apostles' Creed, the Apostles' Creed doesn't say anything about that the Spirit inspired the prophets. What the Apostles' Creed says is we also believe in the Holy Spirit, but it doesn't say anything about the Spirit coming from the Father and the Son. It doesn't say anything about the Spirit being worshipped and glorified equally with the Father and the Son. All it says is that we believe in the Holy Spirit. At the same time, if you look at the Apostles' Creed, there's things in the Apostles' Creed that we don't find in the Nicene Creed. Maybe one thing that's in the Apostles' Creed that people usually have the most questions about is a phrase that we wonder sometimes what it means. In the earliest versions of the Apostles' Creed, there was no mention of the phrase, he descended into hell. But throughout the centuries, this phrase was added by the church. But the wording went back and forth between, sometimes it said, he descended into hell. Sometimes it said, he descended to the dead. A few years ago, with the liturgical changes in the Roman Missal that began during the Advent of 2011, the wording was changed to, it had been, he descended to the dead. In 2011, it was changed to, he descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. And those two clauses are very connected. What they also do, those two clauses call us to understand what they're saying through religious meaning rather than through popular culture and popular meaning. In popular meaning, and the way we use it most often, hell means a place of punishment for evil people. In the biblical world, the word hell is the way Scripture describes the place of all the dead. So it's very different. When we look at the icons, of the resurrection from our Eastern tradition, they show the gates of hell falling away into the shape of a cross. And so what they're portraying in that icon is that because and through Jesus dying, Christ has destroyed death. And because of that, he's changed the fate of all those who died before the crucifixion. In rising from the dead, which the creed says, on the third day he rose again from the dead, in rising from the dead, Christ takes all the deceased with him. So when we pray those words, what we're saying is that we believe that Christ is Lord for all ages, not just for the people of the first century, not just for us today, but that Jesus' saving work is about everyone, from all ages. So that's a phrase that's in the Apostles' Creed that has never been in the Nicene Creed. The Apostles' Creed, if you look at it also, the Apostles' Creed includes the communion of saints, which is one of our beliefs, that we are not created as individuals, that we're created very, very connected to one another. And we're connected to one another whether we're here on earth or we're in heaven. That the communion of saints means is sometimes incomprehensible understanding that we're one community, we're one family of God. The Pope Francis's new encyclical on ecology says this in lots of different ways. Francis, of course, is talking too about the connection of all creation, not just humanity, but all creation. But he stresses especially our responsibility to creation because of our connection to one another also, our reality of being in the communion of saints. So the Apostles' Creed talks about the communion of saints. The Nicene Creed doesn't mention the communion of saints. And remember, we said a minute ago that the creed is not a listing of the major beliefs of the faith, some of them, but not all of them. Because probably what maybe is most startling when you look and compare the creeds is that there's really almost nothing about sacraments in either creed. Now, one sacrament is mentioned in both creeds. In both creeds, we say, that was communion of saints, sorry. Both creeds say that we believe in baptism for the forgiveness of sins. But of course, the primary sacrament, the central sacrament, our core sacrament, the sacrament in which everything leads up to and everything flows from, is the Eucharist. And there isn't a word about Eucharist in the creeds. So, if we said that, if somebody was trying to define the creeds, or define what a creed is, and said, well, a creed is a kind of a handy-dandy summary of the principal components of our belief, that's not totally accurate. Because as we said, if you look at the two of them, it's odd that they don't match up. If they were the major beliefs, all of the major beliefs, they don't match up. And secondly, as we just looked at, both of them leave out some things that we would think are very, very important in our faith. So, if it's not a summary of the Christian faith, what is it? Well, one theologian, Nicholas Lash, suggests to answer that question, that the one way of doing it is to begin with the last word. And of course, if we think about it for a second, we know that the last word of both creeds is amen. So what do we usually say amen to? Right. We usually think of that word as the ending of a prayer, which tells us, which is a clue, that the creed is first and foremost a prayer. So, if it's a prayer, who is it addressed to? Like all prayer, it's addressed to God. So the creed isn't something said to us, these are the things you ought to believe. We don't say the creed to one another as a community as a kind of pledge of fidelity. Here we are all together, and these are the things that we together as a Catholic community say we believe in. But the creed is rather addressed to God. It's us, both as individuals and together as a community, talking to God. Now, the next question is usually, well, why would we have to tell God what the principal beliefs of Christianity are? God presumably knows that. We don't need to remind God of what Christianity is all about. So why are we saying this prayer? First of all, let's go back to Amen for a moment. What does Amen mean? So be it is one way we talk about it, right? It's the root word of Amen, which is a Hebrew word, means something like dependable, reliable. What it's actually saying is, and this I think goes along with so be it, what we're really saying is this we bank on, this we rely on, this we commit ourselves to absolutely. It's a little bit like the phrase, I do. And think about I do for a minute. There's probably maybe several times we use that, but there's two main times that we use that phrase. Do you, John, take Mary as your lawfully wedded wife? I do. And at baptism, or at Easter Vigil, or at the Easter liturgies, when we renew our baptismal promises, Father says, do you believe in God the Father, the maker of heaven and earth? And our response as individuals and as a community is, I do. In both those cases, in the marriage and in the baptismal promises, we're really using I do in exactly the same way. It's not really the answer like, yeah, I can go along with that. Certainly the first one isn't. You wouldn't say, hopefully, do you take Mary as your lawfully wedded wife, and the person think, well, yes, I guess so. She's got this expensive white dress on, and I'm all dressed up, and well, but yeah, I'll listen to that. I do. It's much more than that. It's a statement of commitment. I do. I pledge myself. I'm putting myself on the line. This is something I'm staking my life on. I do. And it's exactly in that same sense that we say I do to the baptismal promises, which of course are simply the creed in question form. During the Easter liturgies, when we renew our baptismal promises, we don't use the creed because we just prayed the creed, but through a question and answer form rather than the prayer as it is. So again, Father would say, do you believe in God the Father, the maker of heaven and earth? And our response is, I do. I bank on this. I rely on this. My life is rooted in this. It's not simply a case of, do you believe, do you agree that Colombo is the capital of Sri Lanka? And you'd say, well, let's see. Sri Lanka, how many other cities are there that I know of in Sri Lanka? I don't know of any others, so it sounds right to me. That's not the kind of answer at all. It's a statement of commitment. When we're asked, do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in God's Son, Jesus? The creed is a prayer of our commitment to God. This is what, before you, this community, and before God, I'm banking my life on. And I think in understanding the creed, that's a very important statement to remember. The shape then, of course, is that the creed takes the shape of a prayer. It's an act of worship to God in which we commit ourselves to God. In some ways, it's a restatement every Sunday of our baptismal promises. of our commitment to God. And as we said before, that's very important because the creed isn't just about saying it. The creed isn't just about reciting it. It's about loving it. It's about living it. Because we're saying amen, we're saying we're banking our life on this. And if my life is banked on this, it should change. It should influence who I am and how I live. Just as the early Christians knew that baptism, where they professed the creed, was a complete change in their life. Because of that, we live it. The creed is not just, again, this abstract list of beliefs. And it's not only a prayer. It's a prayer which connects to our life. But I would say that a lot of times, I don't know about you, but I don't think about it that way. Think, too, about some Sunday when you leave church. Some Sundays when people leave church, you might hear them talking about the homily. You might hear them talking about the music. Have you ever heard anyone say, wow, the way we prayed the creed today really inspired me. It really gave me something new to think about. It really gave me something to do this week. But has the creed become a rote prayer that we pray with everybody else, and then once it's over, there's no impact on our life? In reality, the creed is a prayer that we need to live. The creed needs to be connected to our everyday living. In my book on the creed that I mentioned, what I tried to do for each chapter, which takes a different sentence or phrase of the creed, is to give reflection questions and things to think about that also are things to do that are related to what we're praying about in the creed. On one of your other handout, which gives some questions or some thoughts about a line of the creed, is really done for families. In preparing for this session, I tried to think of something that might help families to use the creed as a prayer, and then take what we're praying and think about what does that mean in my life and in my family's life. So there's all kinds of ways of doing that. There's many different ways, different kinds of questions that would flow from the different phrases, the different sentences of our prayer within the creed. There's a lot of other ways to make connections between the creed and our life. This one is mentioned in the book. It's the idea of, at some point, someday, together as a family, together within your classes of children or youth or adults, or by yourself, is to pray the creed, and after each sentence, pray a prayer of praise. As you read that sentence, about, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, what prayer bubbles up in you that's a prayer of praise to God, that's a prayer of adoration to God? And then a few days later, or a week or so later, pray the prayer again. And this time, after each sentence, pray a prayer of thanksgiving. So because of that, because that's who God is, because that's what our church is, what do I want to say thank you for? And then a few days later, or a week later, or a couple weeks later, pray it again. And this time, after each phrase or sentence, pray a prayer of petition. As I pray that about the Holy Spirit, as I pray that about the church, what's my prayer of need? What do I want to ask God, Jesus, the Spirit for? So right now I invite you to go back to what you wrote at the beginning, or what you had in your mind in the beginning, about what you believe. So don't think about the creeds for a minute. Go back to what you wrote in the beginning. As you look at that now, do you want to change it in any way? Do you want to delete something? Do you want to add something? But it can only be one sentence. Don't write a whole prayer as long as the Nicene Creed. But look at your prayer. Look at your sentence. Is there anything you would change? And then as you look at that, because you believe that, does it call you to live in a certain way? Because you believe that, how does your belief call you to live? Any anybody want to share a thought with us? What do you believe and how did, what does that call you to do?
I believe that God is always with me. So I take all things, good or bad, to Him. And that's where I live.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. So your belief is connected to how you live. It's not an abstract thing. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, we're back there.
I did not change what I believe at the beginning. I said one holy Catholic Church because this is what I am and who I am. And I believe it and love it.
Okay. Great, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, one more.
I left Mana Lana. Mana simply says, I believe in God and in the teachings of His Holy Catholic Church. And if I truly believe that, it has to be reflected in my life. Otherwise, it's a lie. It's not a statement of truth.
Right, right. But for me, too, it's a question that I always need to ask myself, is what I'm saying in this prayer or other prayers, is what I'm saying when I celebrate the sacraments, am I then living that, am I living the meaning of that in the rest of my life? You know? And that's a challenge. Okay, so right then you thought about what you wrote. What I'd invite you to do now is to think about the creed. And you can think about either the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed. What actions in your life does the creeds of the church influence? Now, it might be very similar because most of you probably wrote things about your own belief that are connected to the creeds of the church. So as you look at the creeds, how do those, something in those creeds influence your actions? And then also, because of the creed, how are you called to teach? And because of the creed, what are you called to teach? Do you want to just turn to one other person sitting near you, either next to you or behind you or in front of you? And share your thoughts about one of those questions.
Thank you.
Get into the rut of, you know, even the whole liturgy, not just the creed, but that we do it, I mean, it, because it's a ritual and it's the same all the time, there's blessings in that, but there's also disadvantages, you know, because we don't stop always and think. And yesterday, I don't know if anybody is here who was there, yesterday I did a talk for the diocese, and the topic was finding peace in our 24/7 busy world. But I forgot what I was gonna say. But we were talking about the idea that we need to live in the present moment, but most of us are living, you know, mostly in the future. What am I gonna do once I get out of church? And so I'm not rooted, and it's really hard to do that. And yet that's really what prayer calls us to.
Well, we're taking it for granted.
Yes, taking it for granted, right. Because it's been part of us since our childhood. Mm-hmm. Good, thank you.
How we started is we have the kids all come to a baptism, and then they all renew their baptism with us. And then we break it down each week, and we go around it and around it. And then we say, do you see something that connect to the Nicene Creed.
Great.
And so this way, it becomes almost part of what's happening in their lives as well.
Right.
It isn't something that's just out there.
Right, excellent. I like too, which you know I try to do, is to show the connection that the creeds came from baptism. So many things about our faith are interconnected. And yet sometimes we study them or learn about them in isolation and don't see the connection, that it's all one, you know. And so that's great to help children to do that. Okay, I want to share just a couple other ideas with you, which I think also will hopefully help us, because I have some questions about how it might influence our teaching. And then we'll have a chance to talk for a few more minutes. So one of the things to remember, one of the things that the Apostles' Creed is very scriptural. Most of the things that we pray in the Apostles' Creed come from Scripture. The Nicene Creed is from both Scripture and tradition. In fact, the Nicene Creed, you probably know, comes from the First Ecumenical Council of the Church. You know, Vatican II was the 21st Council. The very first one was in Nicaea in 325. And it was called, as most councils were until Vatican II, was called because of a heresy. The Arian heresy was prevalent, which denied that Jesus, the Son, always existed with the Father. So in effect, Arius was denying the divinity of Christ. And so the bishops gathered and said, that's not what we believe, right? So what are we going to do? How do we say this? And so then a major achievement of this council was to clearly define the divinity of Christ by issuing the Nicene Creed. So the Nicene Creed comes both from Scripture, but also from our tradition because of what was happening in the early centuries. Both creeds, as I mentioned before, have a Trinitarian structure. The way the creeds are organized is around our belief in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so a couple questions for us to think about our teaching is, first, do we focus in our prayer with the children or adults, whoever we're working with, do we focus in our prayer and in our conversations, our discussions, only on Jesus, only on God the Father, only on the Holy Spirit? So it's just something to look at, because a lot of times some of us have a tendency to be connected with, attracted to one person of the Trinity rather than the others. The other thing about that, when we think about the Trinity, that the creeds are structured, is that a lot of times when we think of the Trinity, we think in terms of separate roles. That God the Father is the creator, God is redeemer, God the Holy Spirit is sanctifier. Many theologians and church leaders remind us that when we do that, then we're understanding things from the perspective of performance instead of relationships. And the reality is, one of the things we can say about God, even though anything we say about God is not the whole thing, but that God is relationship. God is relationship. That's what one of the main things the Trinity tells us all about. So even if we say God is creator, God is Father, we're not talking just about roles. We're not describing actions, just actions. We're saying much more than that. We're saying creating is what God is. Being redemptive, being the means by which new life is given, is what God the Son is, not just something God the Son does. Being consoler or inspirer is what the Holy Spirit is, not just what the Holy Spirit does. So one of the ways of talking about the Trinity is that the Trinity is an explosion of love that bursts forth in creation, that bursts forth in humanity, that bursts forth as comforter, that God is constantly outpouring love and unity in Father, Son, and Spirit. And so these are like three ways in which God communicates to us: as creator, as redeemer, as sanctifier. So to live a Trinitarian spirituality, to live the creed, we experience that these are the ways in which God gives God's self to us, Or to look at it from the other side, these are the ways that I know that I'm also related to God. God isn't just related to me as creator, as redeemer, as sanctifier, but I'm related to God too. Because I'm related to God, because God is relationship, then that tells me who I am. Because the Trinity is this relationship of love between Father, Son, and Spirit, it overflows to us. The love of God in the three persons overflows to us so that we can be what God created us to be, which is God-like. That we can do what God does. That we can love, not as perfectly, of course, as God does, but we can love and inspire and bring life to others just as God does. And so some questions for us as catechists is, based on the creed, do we help our children and their families experience God and who God is? Not just what God does. There's a difference. They're intertwined. But what is our image of God? I think our image of God, and that's another whole talk, which could also be a whole class, but there's some things in the Creed book about image of God. There's also another of my books out there, Spirituality, the Catechist, also talks about what's our image of God. Because I think our spirituality, how we pray, how we live, how we act, is very dependent upon our image of God. Many people say, and I believe this, we act like the image of God that we have. There's lots of ways to think about that and reflect on that. Another question to ask ourselves as catechists is, do we help our children understand not only that God relates to them, but how they're related to God? And to help them understand that God's love is so great that it's always overflowing. And because it's overflowing, it totally surrounds us so that we can love as God loves. Okay? So to take the creed and remember that it's in the Trinitarian formula calls us to think about who God is and how God is relationship. So there's just a couple minutes left. I invite you just to think about, is there anything that you'll do differently in the days ahead? In your faith life, yourself personally, in your family, in your ministry as a catechist, because of any ideas that ran through your mind in the last hour. I prefer that we talk about it in small groups, but there's some time. So is there anyone that a thought comes to their mind that you would share with us? Anything you want to do differently?
I teach fourth and fifth grade, and the Nicene Creed is something that they are to be memorizing this year. And so we started off last week's lesson talking about the history of it coming from Nicene in 325. However, it was also taught by me as a listing of what we believe as Catholic Christians. And so I'm excited about taking it as a prayer and talking with children about that and having them really reflect on how they say it when they're at mass and when we say it in class.
Thank you. And I think a lot of us, we've been taught that way, you know, that it is. It's a listing of the basic beliefs. And in one way, yeah, it is, but that's not what it's meant to be. I mean, it's in the form of a prayer, which makes it very different, you know, which makes it more challenging. And gives us a lot more to think about. But I think a lot of us, I facilitate online courses for Boston College and the University of Dayton, and one of Boston College's is on the Creed. And the materials, the videos and books that we use, stress this, that it's a prayer. And most of the people, and these are all adults, you know, most of the people will say on the boards, I never thought about it as a prayer. And that thinking about it as a prayer will change, you know, change the way I pray it at Mass.
Thanks. It doesn't make sense.
Does it make sense?
Don't think of it as a prayer. But it's always been a prayer.
But many of them were taught that it's a list of the things we believe. So it's a statement of belief rather than a prayer to God.
This is a prayer that teaches us what we believe.
It teaches us, but it's more than just teaching us. It's,
and affirms.
Right. But it's also, it presumes too that we already, in some way, have been taught some of this. So it's not just a teaching tool, but it's a way of praying to God and saying to God in, with the community, this is what my life is baked on. This is my commitment.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. But you're right too, because it is some of the major beliefs of our faith. Mm-hmm. It is all intertwined. But I think there's a difference if we only think about it, okay, I'm professing my belief, I'm saying that this is what I believe. Or thinking about it that I'm talking to God, that I'm telling God this is what my life is based on.
But that's what I was taught. We were telling each other this is what we believe. And we were saying to God, yes, I accept it. This is what I was taught and this is what I believe.
That's good. I think some people's experiences, they weren't taught that. They weren't taught that it was a prayer. They were taught more that it was a list of beliefs.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. Enjoy lunch.
Yeah.